So the next talk is going to be about web performance by Stefan. I don't know anything about web performance, so it would be interesting. Welcome.
Thank you. So my name is Stefan Wittermeier. Here's my Twitter account. Today I'm going to talk about web performance. I kind of have two hearts in my chest. The one is I do a lot of Ruby and Rails work, and the other I really love Phoenix. So I will talk a little bit about Ruby too. Sorry for that. Just examples. So what web pages do not have to care about web performance? Are there any? No, they still have to work. Think about web performance. Assuming that you have a web page which has next week's lottery numbers, then you don't have to care about web performance because the content is so good that people would wait forever for their web page to load. So what web pages do have to care about web performance? The web pages which show last week's lottery numbers, because there are probably millions of websites with the same information. So you want to have an edge to compare to the other web pages. So it's always a question about what is the competition, what do I want to achieve? So what's the impact of a slow website? This is a graph by Ilya. He works at Google. He is kind of the web performance guru. And you see here the number of seconds a web page loads and the bounce rate, which is here. Bounce rate means somebody tries to open the web page, it doesn't open, or maybe it's not interesting, and then he or she walks away. We all know how that works. We all have this problem on mobile phones when pages don't load fast enough. So the essential point here is, if you are here, let's say if your web page loads 20 seconds, 1 second less will not get you far. Because this area, that's wasteland. There's no way that you can survive there. You want to be here, and here you can see if you save 1 second, it will make a big, big impact. In general, as a rule of thumb, you can say 5 seconds faster web page, 1 second faster web page will mean 5% less bounce rate. So if you are running an online shop, for example, web performance really is a money maker for you. How's that? What's the reason? It's a human thing. If you check how humans interact with machines, with GUIs, with everything, you see these numbers here. So if a human has to wait like 100 milliseconds, it feels instant for him. That's the reason if I don't know who has a dog or other animals which are trainable. If you treat a dog, it has to be instant. You cannot promise a dog a treat and say, okay, I give it to you in 10 minutes. It has to be instant. And what is logical for dogs, it's the same for humans. We are animals too. So we want instant gratification. So if we wait 300 milliseconds, we kind of realize, okay, we have to wait a little bit. Everything till 1,000 milliseconds, which is a second, is kind of okay. Everything above that is a problem. We do mental context change, and after 10 seconds, we are gone. If your web page loads that slow, normally about 50% of people will bounce right away. So, if you want to play in the GOAT League, you want to stay under 1 second, 1,000 milliseconds of loading time. That's what Google does, for example. That's one of the reasons why Google is so or became so big. Of course, they have a good search index, but there are other search engines out there. Their big secret, most people don't realize that, is speed. Try to see how fast Google answers your request and think about that. And they are aware of that. They are playing with their numbers. They're playing with the system. So here's an experiment Google did. They picked a group of users and slowed down their web page for these users. So this is the amount of time they slowed down the web page, and this is the impact of that speed change. So they lost users by simply slowing down the web page. And we are not talking seconds, we are talking 200 milliseconds, which is not very much. The important thing is it takes time. So if you run a web page and it's slower on one day, for whatever reason, that's not the end of the world. But if it's becoming slower over, like, for the next couple of weeks, then you will lose clients. The same vice versa. If you speed up your web page, you will not see a big impact tomorrow. So if you have a client, or if you're working in a company and you have to argue that with your boss, you have to tell people in advance, okay, this is going to take time. Give me 8 weeks. Let's talk numbers in 8 weeks. That's what you want to do. No early promises like tomorrow or next week. So what is super important to realize is that we are working in a mobile-first environment. We want to have fast web pages on mobile devices, not on our desktop. It's good if they are fast there too, but you have to fix the mobile device first. So our aim here is to have 1,000 millisecond time limit on a 3G connection. That's kind of the Mount Everest for web performance. What does that mean? That means because of the overhead we have, we need a DNS lookup. Any web page needs a DNS lookup first. We need a TCP connection. We need a TSL handshake. We need the actual HTTP request. We all need that. And that takes time. So at the end, we are left with a 400 millisecond time frame which we can use on the server to render our HTML page on the server. And that's not a lot of time. So some things you cannot fix within your environment. If it's I don't care if it's Rails or Phoenix or Django or whatever. If you are delivering a 3 megabyte big JavaScript file, your web page will never be fast. So you always have to think about the whole picture, not just the server, but everything. And JavaScript is a big, big performance bottleneck. So how does it work? How does a browser do simple rendering of a web page? At first, the browser fetches the HTML file from the server. So the browser says get index.html, for example. And then it gets that file from the web server. And the browser starts rendering the DOM. Next thing is the browser fetches the CSS file and renders the CSS on. Until now, nothing is displayed on the display. Nothing. Now it's fetching the JavaScript. And here it's getting a little bit tricky. Because for many things, the browser will wait, but for a couple of things the browser will not wait. But at the end, JavaScript is a big bottleneck here. So once the browser decides that it has everything, it will start rendering the web page. That's the moment where you see the first pixels arrive on the display. And you still see some moving around, where things load from the internet and you see moving of pictures, moving of fonts, everything. we do have to think about the time the computer needs on the browser side. So that's a minimum of 100 milliseconds, which we have to subtract from the 400. So right now we are talking about 300. And that's on quite fast CPU and good RAM. Do not forget that many, many people are using old phones or cheap phones or whatever. Not everybody has the latest X iPhone on an LTE connection. Most people do not. So how does the download of a file works? HTTP uses TCP, and believe it or not, that is the biggest bottleneck in the very beginning, because when TCP was created, the people who did that didn't know how big the bandwidth was they are going to use. So they thought, okay, let's start with a small amount of data and double that, and then double that again until we get some sort of error. And then we go one or two steps back. So what happens if you download a file? First of all, you have to do the TCP three-way handshake. And this is the latency, but that's the time it takes from the server to the browser and vice versa. So we have to get these three errors, and then with this one here, the browser asks the web server get index.html. That's the first file it needs, the HTML file. And the server says, okay, I'll give you that, but let's take it easy. I sent you 10 segments because we don't know about the bandwidth. TCP doesn't know about the bandwidth. So once these packets arrive at the browser says, okay, acknowledge, I got them. And then the server says, okay, let's double that. So you see here, the big problem is latency. And again, that's the one lesson I want you to bring home. Latency is your big problem. You don't want to have a web server in the US, for example, if your customers are here. You want to have a web server here, which is near to your customer. Because even if your customer has fiber or LTE or whatever, the biggest bandwidth available, it doesn't give him an advantage here. That's good if he or she wants to use Netflix, downloading big files, then fiber is interesting. But if you are using a normal web page, this is your big bottleneck, latency. The time between the browser and the server, not the bandwidth. So to give you an idea how much payload we are talking, with the first round trip you get 14 KB, then 29, 57, 140. So let's assume your web page, just the index file, takes about 200 kilobytes compressed. Then that would take at least 4 round trips. And that's plus the TCP handshake and plus TSL, which we don't have here. And then the browser hasn't rendered a single thing because it doesn't have the CSS yet. With HTTP2, you can use that same connection sending more than one file, which is a big improvement, but you still have TCP slow start. That's the whole process is called TCP slow start. So what does it mean? I have an example from a Ruby conference in Minsk I went to 1 or 2 months ago, in April here. This web page you can use to test any web page, and it will give you a waterfall. And let's see how this works out for rubyconference.by. You see that takes more than 5 seconds to load, so that's pretty slow. And why is that? The main problem is here. So it takes nearly 2 seconds to download the very first file. That's the index, that's the HTML file. And then you see here a couple of CSS files downloaded not as one file but as multiple files. And here's a big difference between HTTP 1 and HTTP 2. If you're using HTTP HTTP 1, you want to have every CSS thing in one file, because that's going to be the fastest way of delivering it. If you're using HTTP 2, you don't care, because HTTP 2 can deliver that as fast in multiple files as in one file from HTTP 1. And then actually multiple files can become better because of caching. I'll talk about caching later. So unfortunately, there's no one size fits all. Anyhow, this page is pretty slow. To give you an idea, so now it starts, but it's still not ready. You see, and here's the JavaScript. JavaScript I'm talking about. So, do we really have to have JavaScript for this, or could we get away with a simpler web page? The information the user wants is very simple. You still see the web page is still loading, just for the because of the animation. So you really want to think twice when you do some sort of magic which looks nice, nice eye candy, but you really want to think about how long does that take to render on the client. So that was 3G. Let's see how it works with ATE. It's much faster, but still, you know, not as fast as you really wanted. And again, the amount of information here is very minimal. So, how fast can you get a web page? And I want to show you an extreme example. This is my web page, wintermeyer-consulting.de, and that loads in 500 milliseconds on the same connection. So let's see how fast that feels. And that, here's the waterfall. So you see the first file is getting loaded very fast. We're talking less than 400 milliseconds. And let's see how fast that feels. Oh, that's fast. And that's, again, that's kind of the gold standard. You don't have to be that fast, but you want to set your own limit. I'm talking about that later, how important it is to set yourself a limit. So now, I know this is an Elixir conference. So is it okay if I show you a couple of Ruby example code? Are you fine with that? Okay. So we're going to talk about an online shop. And who's familiar with Raids? Okay, so then you know what this means. We are scaffolding a simple application. This is our data model. So we have a category, we have products, we have users, we have revenues. The products belong to categories, and the products have many revenues. And we have a number of stars method here, which calculates the average rating for a given product. So we fill this with these seats. We are talking about 100 products and 50 users. Each user does 3 reviews. And this is index HTML, pretty normal. That's the only difference is here we are using number to currency to display a nice currency number here, and we do this thing here to display the review. So this page looks with a little bit of CSS magic like this. A super simple page, nothing fancy. This takes on my laptop about 500 milliseconds to render. So we are way out of our area where you want to be, which is below 400 milliseconds, actually below 300 milliseconds. Because we cannot change this here. We cannot improve that. So many people are asking me, okay, why you're using development here? I will use production later in the table where I compare the times. The problem doesn't move away with production, it's still slow. So what I'm doing with Rails, first thing always is using fragment caching. That's the lowest hanging fruit available. So to do that, you have to activate the cache on in development. And the first thing is every single row. So here's a table, and we cache now every single row. That's done by two lines of code. Cache product do and end. Let's see how much. And we have to do this touch here, because if we change the reviews, we have to touch the product to invalidate the cache. Otherwise, we would deliver an old cache. So, wow, here. From 500 to 80 with two lines of code. That was quick money. But we want to do the whole table too. So if you want to cache not only one row but the whole table, we add another two lines of code, this one here and that one. And now let's see the numbers. We are down to 53. So four lines of code, 10 times more speed. That was Rails. We don't have these extreme problems with Phoenix. Still, caching is always a good idea, but this part here works for both worlds. So here we are using the method number of days, and we use it every time we render a product. And that's kind of stupid, because the review only changes, or the average review only changes if you have new reviews or if you delete reviews. So you don't have to calculate it every time you want to display a product. What you want to do is you want to add a migration and store the value in the table of products. And then using hooks to store that information, to calculate that information and to store it. So that you only have to calculate it once and not every time. And if you do that, you get down to 40 milliseconds. And here is 35 for production environment. So that's a big improvement here. The big warning about caching is the first request is always going to be a little bit slower than before, because you have to write the cache. We're talking about a millisecond or something. So it's not a big deal, but you have to think about it. Cache doesn't give you a benefit right away. You have to warm it up once before. So do you need more speed? And this is a slide from the Ruby conference. You want to go with Phoenix, because Phoenix is, in my average projects, Phoenix is like 10 times faster than Rails. So that's a no-brainer. But let's go one step further. HTTP caching. Any web browser, any proxy in the web, only wants to fetch stuff once. So let's create the idea of etext and last modified. What does that mean? The web browser is going to contact the server and saying, okay, my user wants to fetch this HTML file. I have a cached copy. It's a week old. Is that still good? Can I use that? And the browser says, yep, go ahead. That hasn't changed. That's a 304. So at that time, you do not invest much time on the server, because you don't have to render the templates, etc. You just have to check, is this set of data still good? And that's one SQL query. So it's super fast. So what does it? How does it look if you don't have this activated? Here we have two times we fetch a file with curl on the command line, and you see two different etext. So for curl or for any other problems, this means two different HTML files. And this is Ruby code, if we do fresh when etext here, then we get the same etext. So now we can get a 304 not modified, because here we ask if none match within the header, which every browser automatically does. So this is a win-win. Not only is the browser faster, but you need less resources on the server too. So you really, that's a big win actually, because you don't have to invest so much in servers. Let's assume this is not good enough. We want to see how far can we go in this process. We can preheat our cache. We can do that off in the offline hours. So a normal web shop, for example, has peak hours, like during the day, but not in the night. But the computers are there, and they are running, and they don't care. So let them warm up the cache, brute force wise. So what is the last thing? What do people or companies do if they're really, really fast? Then they think about, do I really have to trigger Phoenix, Rails, Django, whatever? Is there a way to get round of that? Because this is a bottleneck. And yes, you can do that. In a typical Rails application, for example, you have this public directory, which you have in any framework, where stuff is stored like the 404 file. You can use that to deliver your files too. In Rails, you would do that with a action page caching gem. But you could do the same with Phoenix and other frameworks. It's complicated. It's not easy, but it's doable. So once you do that, every file gets stored in the file system, gzipped already. So when a new user comes and asks for that file, the Nginx or Apache or whatever web server looks in that directory first, and when it finds a file there, it will deliver that file, not contacting Phoenix or Rails or whatever anymore. Well, that's the fastest way of doing it. And because it's already gzipped here, you will even save the time of compression. And again, brute force is your friend. We are talking about computers. They don't have feelings. They don't have to sleep at night. So the tricky part here is, how do I delete old files? Because that's a problem. Let's assume I have a product page, and the product changes, the price change, and I still have the static file somewhere. So I have to think about that too. And with Rails, for example, I could use this code here to delete that file. And then every now and then people ask me, yeah, but I have customized pages. Every user gets a different page in my web page, in my web shop. I cannot catch that. That's impossible. And it is possible, you just have to think a little bit more about that. And I'll give you an example. So let's assume we have a user base of 10 million users. And let's assume we want to, this is just an example from an old talk here, we want to give customized versions of a specific web page to all of these 10 million users. What does it mean? The web page takes about 28k, it's compressed obviously, times 10 million is 0.26 terabyte, which is nothing today. Hard drive space is super cheap. So we can actually cache for 10 million users without any problem all the patches on our web server. And again, this is going to save you a lot of money server-wise. Nginx can use cookies to decide, okay, who is that, which static file is going to deliver to that. Again, it's complicated, it's a lot of work, but it means a very fast web page. So let's go back, come back to the basics. HTTP1 versus HTTP2. In general, if you don't change anything else, HTTP2 will mean about a 20% performance boost. So it's a very easy win. You really want to do that. Let's talk about CDNs in HTTP2. The problem here is CDNs have been good for everybody for the last 10 years. But with HTTP2, things change because we are still having the slow start problem from TCP. We don't want to open multiple connections without the need. We want to use the same connection, which is always as wide as possible to deliver everything. So with HTTP2, it's the first time we want to deliver all the graphics, everything from one server and not from multiple CDN servers. CDNs still have many cases where you need a CDN. They are very good with denial of service attacks. They are very good in distributing software updates, etc. But for a normal web page, a normal web shop, it's better to deliver everything from the same server. So that's a big, big change. Image formats. I know this is old news, but still, most web pages do not use the best image format available and do not compress the images optimal. You want to deliver the best available format with the least amount of payload. So right now we are talking mostly about JPEG, PNG and WebP. And I guess nobody's using WebP here in the room. Most people do not, but you could. This is the current state. So if your user, for example, uses Chrome, which is a big number of users, you can deliver WebP, which means you can deliver a better quality for less bandwidth. That's a big win for both sides. Let's talk about CSS. It's very easy. Less CSS equals faster web page. So really, really think about what you are delivering to your browser. The browser not only has to fetch the content bandwidth-wise, but also to compute it, to compile it. So it makes a big difference if you have a small CSS file or a big CSS file. What about web fonts? That's a never-ending story of problems. If it's possible, do not use them. And if you really have to use them, test it and find the best way of storing them on your server. Because we all know this problem, you load a web page and then the page moves just because of some crazy font. And the problem is, people who are doing this, the CSS, the designers, they are not aware of the web performance issues. They look at the screen and say, okay, I want to have that as beautiful as possible. So you as techies have to go to them and say, okay, I understand your need to have a beautiful web page, but please be aware of the consequences. This will make our web page slower. We will lose customers just because of this. So you have to start a communication because designers cannot know that. What about Apache versus Nginx? I really do not care. Use whatever you want to. Both very nice web servers. What about Prodly versus GZIP? Prodly is a fairly new compression method. And you really want to use both. Right now, about 75% of browsers out there, maybe even more, I don't have the actual numbers from today, support Prodly. So there's no reason of not delivering it. And that means about 5 to 10% less file size, and you need less CPU power on the server to actually create these files. So you really want to do both. What about Heroku versus Bare Metal? And Heroku is just an example here. I mean all sorts of services which offer easy deployment. They are good for a quick start. I give that, it's easy to say. But web performance wise, they are normally kind of slow. So if you really want to get a very, very quick website, you want to host it on Bare Metal. You want to host your own server somewhere. And by the way, you are going to save money with that too, because Heroku and other services are quite expensive once you have a running system. They are cheap in the beginning, but they have to make a living, and they make a living from web pages which get more people on them. So what can we do within the HTML? One important thing is preloading and prefetching. For example, you can do a DNS prefetch. If you have a web page and you know it's very likely that in the future, like with the next page, your user needs a resource from another server, then you can tell the browser, okay, I'm going to use that URL in the future. Why don't you call the DNS server and ask for the IP address? And then the browser says, okay, right now I'm bored, I don't have anything to do. So why don't I look in the future and do that DNS fetch yet? So that's going to save time. The same can be done with actual resources, JavaScript files, CSS files, images, whatever. If you know that it's very likely that you need to use that file in the future, you can tell the browser, okay, go ahead and do that now, if you have time. And the browser will do that when it's having time. There's no penalty. And if you use that, you can tell Nginx and Apache to push these files too. So HTTP2 doesn't only have GET requests, but it also can push actively information to the browser. That's very tricky, but can be quite fast. And now, as you probably remember from the beginning, what is the most important tool at our hands? It's a time budget. So whatever you do, you have to set a time budget. And I don't care if you say, okay, my web page loads in 5 seconds and that's good enough for me, or I want to be in the gold league, I want to be below the 1 second. Stick with that number. Because there will come the day when some marketing guy comes to your office and says, yeah, I saw this nice animation, I want that animation. We need that animation. And then you have to watch at your numbers and say, yeah, we can do that, but this will kill our time budget. So we either have to destroy another feature on our web page, or we cannot implement this feature. So you always want to live with your time budget. That's very important. For any new feature, for any code change, you always have to be within the time budget. So is web performance really that hard? Yes, it is. It is super hard, but again, it pays off. You will get more customers on your web page, you will have a lower bounce rate, and you will save money for your servers. So it's a win-win. If you want to dive more into the topic, this is the Web Performance Bible. It was written by Ilya. It's available free as an HTML version here, and you can buy the book from away. So this is really a very good book. I post about web performance and other stuff on my Twitter account, so feel free to follow me there. And if you have a question after this talk, you can ask me here, of course, but if you have a question tomorrow, feel free to send me an email, give me some time to answer it. Are there any questions right now?
You have mentioned generating pages for 1 million users.
10.
Or 10, yeah. Can you use this approach in practice?
Yes.
And in what conditions?
Online shops.
Hmm?
Online shops. For online shops, the typical scenario for this is an online shop, because most online shops have some customization, and most online shops see the benefit of a fast web page. For them, it's a very easy calculation. They see fast web page, we sell more.
Yeah, and what was the amount of data used there? Because usually this leads to combinatory explosion, and you have like 10 billion pages to render in 1 hour.
I did the math here.
Mm-hmm.
You really have to do the math. It's not that complicated, and it's not that much amount of data. Hard drive space is very cheap. So for this example, with 10 million users, and most web shops don't have 10 million users, it was just 0.26 terabyte, which is nothing today. Totally nothing. So it's easy once you get through it. It's just complicated and impossible if you don't think it to the end. Of course, if you think first time about this, you think, okay, that's impossible. Too many users. But actually it is. It's quite easy. And if you really want to save storage, you actually can use these magic file systems which deduplicate stuff. Then you can even store more.
You know, this GDPR, it might affect that, because you have to provide the user a way to delete that cache.
No problem either.
It is in effect right now.
Yeah, but it's not a technical problem. You can do the deletion. It's not a problem.
So, just to clarify, what if I had to update the page, which is pre-rendered with 10 million users? I would have to recalculate this 260 gigabytes.
Of course, yeah.
How fast is that in practice?
Okay, what you would do in practice is you delete everything, that's fast. And then you start re-rendering all the files over time. There's no need to do it right away.
So lazily, sort of.
Yeah, you do that whenever you have time. Worst case scenario is that for the next user it's going to be a little bit slower. But that's something I can live with. Of course, you cannot compute 10 million pages within a minute. It's impossible. But you can do that overnight.
Different way of caching pages that are unique for users. Like, for example, if you have most content on the page that is common for everyone, you cache that and then use some JavaScript on the client to customize page for every user. What's the web performance perspective on that approach?
JavaScript is always a performance killer. Always. So, it's a good solution, but if we are talking about the gold standard, you really want to think about it. So there's no one size fits all. It all depends on your time budget. If you have a time budget which makes it possible, you can go that way. It's the way most companies solve this problem. But if you are below the time budget, then you have to solve it differently. So it's all like, again, the best example is Google. Try Google on your mobile phone on a crappy connection and still fast. It's only because they set a time budget and they stick within the time budget. Do we have another question? Okay, then. Thank you for having me.